So this is a talk in two parts. The first of which can be seen as a long introduction to the second one, with a kind of a weak transition between both. But I wanted to show you some pictures that I find nice. So it starts with the usual slide that we mathematicians give to biological audiences. So it's nice to be here and not be forced to explain what I mean by the fact that we observe patterns and we want to infer the processes. So maybe I think that most of us here in this room do one of these dots or several of these, design probabilistic models of evolutionary processes, generating similar patterns as those observed in nature, as Steve emphasized, and allowing for the inference of these processes from real data. And in this talk, I will assume that the data is a phylogeny, a gene tree or a species tree, already inferred from multiple sequence alignment. So we will kind of study the properties of some ultrametric trees, because actually what happens is that we don't have the whole data about the whole history about the phylogeny. And here you see this this picture of a phylogeny where the origin of time is here, and you have this you have these speciations here, these extinctions here, or you can like see these crosses as deaths, and these small segments as births, and here these yellow dots as sampling sequences from the contemporary individuals. And actually what we only have is the reconstructed phylogeny, which is the tree spanned by these yellow dots here. And so there is a different terminology in biology and in math. So in phylogenetics, this tree is called the reconstructed tree, and in math we call that the reduced tree. Okay, so I will use both invariably. At high T, because it has started at some time, so here it's supposed to be capital T. So what's the idea behind the reduced trees? That you just remove all the lineages that are extinct by the fixed time, capital T. Actually, the reduced tree is one-to-one with the sphere of radius, capital T, which are these yellow dots here, the particles alive at time T, the species, the contemporary species, or the contemporary individuals. So the sphere of radius, capital T, is just the set of points which are at the distance capital T from the root, as Steve just showed. So the sphere is ultrametric, as Steve said, in the sense that the distance between two tips is smaller than the maximum of any two pairs, of any two distances like that. So usually this tree is called an ultrametric tree, but of course it's not the distance on the tree which is ultrametric, but only on the sphere, which is here. And now I want to introduce a seemingly more general framework. So I take I, a compact interval, and f, a function from I to R plus, and I will call f a comb if for any epsilon positive, the set of points of this interval where f is larger than epsilon is finite. Okay, so as probabilists, we typically think of this object as the realization of a Poisson point process. So for any st in I, I will define df, the distance between s and t, which is 2 times the supremum of f on the interval st. Okay, and so it's easy to show that df is an ultrametric distance on the zeros of f, where you have just to take the quotient space on the intervals where the function f is constantly equal to zero. And I will call this ultrametric distance the comb metric, okay? So a picture to make this clear. So imagine that the comb has finite support. So it's just so here it's just a function which has a support which is finite here, as you see. And now if you take 2 points on the zeros of f, so if you take all the points here in this interval, they are identified by taking the quotient. But if you take now the red dot and the blue dot, the distance between these two dots is the maximum of the function on this interval, so it's here, this or two times this distance. And the distance between the blue and the red is this distance, two times this height. And of course, you see that the distance between the red and the green is this size. So you see that this metric is ultrametric, and you can see that the comb metric space is one-to-one with an ultrametric tree, so I put quotes because it's not really the tree which is ultrametric. So you see that, so here you take a dashed line, you divide it into two, and when it encounters the next height of f, or the next point of the graph, it divides into two, etc. Okay? And so you see that the distance between the red and the blue in this tree is exactly this height. Between the red and the blue and the green, it's exactly this height. And between the red and the green, it's exactly this height. Okay, so you see that there is this one-to-one relationship between a comb metric space and an ultrametric tree. Okay? So what about the general case? So we have this representation theorem saying that actually any compact ultrametric space with no isolated point is isometric to a properly completed comb metric space. So if you take any compact ultrametric space, you can always embed it by an isometry into some comb metric space for some well-chosen comb. In particular, if you take any real tree and you take the sphere, which is the set of points of the tree at the same distance, let's say capital T, from the root, this is an ultrametric space, and it is compact if the underlying real tree is locally compact. And a corollary of this statement is that any sphere of a locally compact real tree is isometric to a comb metric space. And if you think of our favorite tree, the Brownian tree, the Brownian continuum random tree, you know that the Brownian tree has as a contour process Brownian motion. And so the... well, whatever you can... Yeah. Normalize the Brownian excursion. Yeah. You know that the distances to the root of these points are the depth of the excursions, and so they can be represented by a Poisson point process with this intensity. Okay, and for Levy trees, we treated this question and tried to let's say display the comb that was behind the ultrametric structure of Levy trees at some fixed height from the root. In this paper that actually in a collaboration with Leah Popovich that originated in the first edition of this meeting. So I just show you some examples of these comb metrics. The first one is the p-adic comb. So here I took the dyadic numbers. So you know that the set of non-stationary sequences of zeros and ones is ultrametric when you embed it with the Hamming distance. So you take two sequences, x and y, and the distance between these two sequences is 2 to the power minus the minimum, the least index where the sequences differ. Okay? So if you take any sequence starting with 1001 and any sequence starting with 1011, the distance between both is one over eight, okay, 1/8. Okay, so now, of course, we know that this set U is ultrametric because it can be represented by the boundary of the infinite binary tree. Okay, it's the boundary of the infinite binary tree where you go to the left and to the right, and you put a zero when you go to the left and one when you go to the right. And actually, you can see it. You can see the ultrametric structure in another way by mapping each sequence to the interval 0, 1 by this very well-known mapping. And here you see that on this, when you embed the infinite sequences in the interval 0, 1, you see that the distance between the blue dot, this one, this sequence, or any sequence starting with this motif, and the red dot, any sequence starting with this motif, is exactly the maximum of this function over this interval, which is 1/8. Okay. So why is the red dot here? It's because any sequence which begins with this motif is exactly, so it's 1 × 1/2 plus 0 × 1/4, meaning that you're in the left in this interval, and then the 0 × 1/8, meaning that you're in this interval, and 1 × 1/16, meaning that you're in this interval. Okay, so it's a deterministic comb, which you can, of course, it's infinite near zero. With this object, you can also construct exchangeable coalescents. So you take a deterministic comb on 0, 1, and VI, IID random variables uniform in 0, 1. And then you define the partition RF of T for each positive T on the set of integer numbers by the equivalence relation. Say that I and J are in relation if the distance in the comb metric between VI and VJ is smaller than T. Okay? So you throw uniform independent random variables in 0, 1, and then you declare that for any T, that I and J are in relation if their distance in the comb metric is smaller than T. Okay? So you see that as T increases, the equivalence classes of this process are bigger and bigger. Okay? And you can see, of course, that the law of this process, RF of T, is exchangeable, meaning that when you permute integers, you don't change the law of this process. So it's an exchangeable coalescent process. And actually, there is a very well-known construction of an exchangeable coalescent process by this means, which is the construction by Aldous of the Kingman coalescent. So previously F was a deterministic comb, and now you take for F a random comb defined as the sum of a J of tau J indicator of the point UJ, where now the UJs are IID uniforms on 0, 1, independent from the VIs. And of course, the tau Js are the quiescence times in the Kingman coalescent, which are the sum of the EKs, the rest of the sum, where the EK are independent exponential random variables with parameter K times K minus 1 over 2. And then the process accelerated by a factor 2 has exactly the same law as the Kingman coalescent. Okay, so this is known as Aldous's construction. Maybe if we go back to this picture here. So it means that here, all these heights, so here is the sum of, this height is exactly the sum of all your exponential random variables. Then you take away the first one, which is the difference between this height and this height. Then you take away the third one, and you get all these heights, and you throw them independently, uniformly, in the interval 0, 1, okay? Then you throw another collection of random variables, and you construct the random partition or the random coalescent process, as I did here, and you get the Kingman coalescent. Actually, this picture gives you a little more than just the structure of the tree, but also the proportion of leaves descending from each node. And of course, my favorite one, the third example, is the coalescent point process. So here, the comb is taken by IID random variables till that the first value larger than capital T. And you define the comb this way, and the structure that that it induces on the interval is an ultrametric tree, and we will call it coalescent point process, as Léa and David coined this term. So of course, there's a more general definition, replacing these IID random variables by a Poisson point process, correctly stopped, exactly as in the Brownian tree. You just throw a Poisson point process with the intensity dx dy over y2. And actually, so as Steve emphasized, what we would like is to have a nice process that produces this pattern, because, okay, this the law of an ultrametric tree is very easy to compute in this case. It's just the product of the densities evaluated at each depth. And actually, if you consider a birth-death process started at time zero with one particle, and you assume that the birth rate may depend on absolute time, that the death rate may depend on time and on a non-heritable trait such as age, then the reconstructed tree at time capital T is a coalescent point process. So you cannot get this theorem if B depends also on a non-heritable trait, and it's of course worse if there is dependence on a heritable trait. And actually, so if you're given these Bs and these Ds, you would like to characterize the common distribution of these node depths, okay? They are IID, but if you want to do some inference, you want to characterize the law of these node depths from the ingredients of the model. Actually, you can do that by considering 1 over the tail of the common distribution of these node depths. So why 1 over the tail? I don't know why, but it turns out that it's the right object to consider, and it's the unique solution to some explicit linear integral differential equation that can be expressed in terms of the ingredients of the model. And if B and D are actually time homogeneous, F can also be obtained by inverting an explicit Laplace transform. As you may know, it's always simpler to do the first than the second one, but for us mathematicians, it's nice to have a more explicit result. And the result still holds if you have bottlenecks, meaning that at some fixed points in time, you kill some lineages with the same probability independently, and if you partially sample tips as on the first picture. So in this case, the likelihoods are in product form, and the applications are simple because you can, as Steve said, you can compute the likelihood of a given ultrametric tree and perform an inference of your parameters from the tree. So I just show you two applications. The first application is a question that we tried to answer with Helen Alexander and Tanya Stadler, which is, do species age? So the kind of age dependence that we put in the model here, as you just saw, is the age dependence in the death rate. Okay, it's equivalent actually to put age dependence in the death rate and saying that the lifetime of a species or of an individual here, of a species, is general. And the way that we chose to parameterize the lifetime distribution of species is by a gamma random variable. Not that it's fundamentally the best choice, but it nicely interpolates with the exponential, and it's easier to invert Laplace transforms. So you take a model where the so maybe Steve, you were speaking of this phylogeny in your talk.
No, this is later. This is in science.
Okay. Yeah. This one is just in nature. So you take a phylogeny. You take a model where so speciation rate is a constant equal to b. The lifetime of species is gamma distributed. And you want to infer the best speciation rate and the best k here, or ks, of your gamma distributed lifetime, likely to have produced this pattern, okay, this tree. You first do that on simulations to check that your inference method does well. Actually, it does not really well for each individual parameter, but for this compound parameter, it does well. You can accurately recover B and M from a maximum likelihood estimation done on simulated trees with known parameters. And when we did that on the bird phylogeny with these 10,000 extant bird species, we rejected the exponential model with a very with much confidence. And so this shape parameter that we inferred is very different from one. When it is one, we are back to the exponential model. And it's far greater than one, meaning that the extinction rate increases with age. So seemingly, of course, it's only one tree, as Nick Barton would emphasize. But if you have confidence in this estimation, then you can deduce that the species are more prone to extinction where they're older. And just for the love of real figures, here the average lifetime that we inferred is approximately 15 million years, and the speciation rate is 0.1 per million year. We also did that in another paper with Rampal Etienne and Hélène Morlon in another framework, which tried to address the question of the duration of speciation. Okay? In all these models, which are called lineage-based, because you consider that species are a single particle, a single lineage, without explicit knowledge of what happens inside the species, a birth event is a speciation event, and so it's instantaneous. Okay? What we wanted to do in this paper is try to account for the fact that the speciation process, of course, is not instantaneous, even in the timescale of the species lifetime, okay? Even in this timescale. So here, I didn't want to enter the details, so I didn't specify very well the model, but it's published, so you can have a look at this paper here. The model is just a population-level model where each species is represented by a set of populations, a set of colonies, that gradually diverge from each other with time. And the speciation time is when the first population of this set of this cloud of populations has sufficiently differentiated from the mother species. If you take this time as a speciation time, actually we can produce from this model a phylogeny of species. It's not a simple task, but we have an algorithm to produce from this genealogy of populations a phylogeny of species. And when we did the test on simulations, we had a quite efficient inference of not of all parameters, but of this compound parameter, which is the duration of speciation. So then, be confident or not in this inference result, but so we did that for 46 bird clades taken from the bird phylogeny, And we inferred this distribution of the duration of speciation ranging from 10,000 years to 10 million years. So now I try to make this weak transition I was talking about in the beginning of the talk between the two parts. Okay. So the nice feature of coalescent point processes is that they are process based. Okay, behind the coalescent point process there is a birth death process. They are very tractable mathematically because it's just a sequence of independent random variables. And they allow for likelihood-based methods that can allow the researcher to make inferences from real phylogenies. The shortcomings of this method or this framework is that the models are lineage-based. They ignore completely what happens at the individual level, or even at the population level. And actually, so that's where the transition is not so weak. The topology of all these trees is always the same. Okay, so the shape of coalescent point processes is always the same. It's always equivalent to a Yule tree. And what is this topology distribution? It's just a uniform distribution over trees with ranked node depth, because when you permute the depth of your tree, you don't change the distribution, you don't change the probability, and so all these trees have the same probability, and so this probability is the uniform distribution. In contrast, it is very well known, and David Aldous has made an important contribution to this field, that real phylogenies have a distribution which is far from the Yule distribution. They are more unbalanced. They're more unbalanced than the Yule tree. So what we wanted to do with Nicolas Lartillo, Todd Parsons, and Guillaume Achaz is to design a non-exchangeable individual-based model of phylogeny, which is biologically reasonable, of course. Starts from the description of individuals and where species are different, of course, because if species don't play different roles, you always get the same topology and distribution. And of course, we want this model to be mathematically tractable and fitting empirical patterns such as the imbalance of real phylogenies. We designed this model under the Red Queen hypothesis from, you know, that... This picture from Alice in Wonderland, where the landscape always changes and you have to run to stay in the same at the same position, and that can be summed up in this sentence: all species are continually replaced by younger, fitter species. Okay, so the idea here is that some new species arise. With the key innovations, or they invade new niches, and because they have this, because they innovate, they chase the old species that are here. If these species do not evolve in their turn, which happens in the well-known phenomenon of what is called evolutionary arms races. Here, what we wanted to do is to have a model which is very poor in parameters, meaning that here the fitness is not parameterized. It's only a rank fitness which is mediated by the order of appearance. Okay. So what's this model? It's the asymmetric multi-species model where when you have n species. All the individuals perform a multi-type logistic branching process. So you have a per capita birth rate lambda, death rate mu, and you also have a competition at a rate which depends on the ranks of the species. Okay? So Cij is the competition which is felt by each individual of species I from each individual of species j, where species I is always younger than species j. Okay? So you assume that you have ranked your species from the youngest to the oldest. And so to take into account this idea that the younger species do not feel the competition from the older species, we took Cij equals zero. Cii, which is the intraspecific competition, equals to C over the scaling parameter K. And Cji, which is the competition felt by older species, by younger species, taken equal to D over K. So now we will call instead of ranks, we'll say levels. And so the species at level one is the younger species. Species at level two is the second younger species. And then, of course, if you start with an initial condition in abundances, which is of the order of K, then as K tends to infinity, the rescaled abundances as a process weakly converge to the solution to this very simple multidimensional ODE, which has an equilibrium state which is geometric. Okay, so you take kappa equals lambda minus mu over c, alpha equals 1 minus d over c, which is a kind of selection coefficient, and then the asymptotic behavior of this ODE is this set of equilibrium states which are geometrically decreasing with the rank of your species. Okay, so your younger species are more abundant. The abundance, the equilibrium abundance of the younger species is kappa, and then you have kappa alpha squared, etc. So now we assume that, so this was for a fixed set of species, and now you assume that you have speciation by point mutation. So each newborn in each of these species is a mutant with probability epsilon k, and we take the usual Champagnat scaling, epsilon k, which is greater than e to the minus vk for some v, and smaller than 1 over k log k. Then we get this separation of time scales, as Sylvie nicely showed, and Anton also yesterday. And we get this theorem. If we define t sub n as the first time when the number of species exceeds n, then the number of the number of species is a pure birth process with this birth rate. And as k tends to infinity, then you define nt as a pure birth process with this birth rate. And then as k tends to infinity, the rescaled abundances of your species, properly rescaled by the time between two mutations, converges in the sense of finite dimensional distributions to the process of equilibrium abundances of the deterministic corresponding process. Actually, we are working, as Todd mentioned yesterday, we are working on a possibly stronger statement. And here, if you look at the phylogeny, what you get is this. So here we are in forward time. You have all your species here ranked from the youngest or the most recent to the oldest. And suddenly, at a fixed rate, there is an individual coming from a geometrically distributed level, giving rise to a mutant, giving rise to a new species, and this species becomes the new, most recent species. Okay? So at this time, all species, species levels are shifted by plus one, and the new species takes the place at level one, okay? So in the new time scale, at constant rate rho, speciation occurs from the species at level I with probability, with the geometrically distributed probability. All species simultaneously shift up their level by plus one, and the new species occupies the newly vacated bottom level because it's the younger species. And now if you look at the backward in time picture, it's just this picture, where all levels are shifted by minus one, and the level and the species at level one coalesces with the geometrically distributed level. Okay? So that's a picture or process we call the shift down lookup coalescent, because the species here at level one looks up to a level and coalesces there. So the problem with this process, as Tom Kurtz said yesterday, is that you have hidden variables, which are the levels of the species. And if you want to simulate the process, of course, you simulate the process with the knowledge of the variables. But if you want to infer the process from the tree, you have to augment the data with all the levels, all the level changes through the diversification process. And that can be very heavy in terms of computation time. And so what we try to do is a reduction in dimension thanks to intertwining theory. So what's intertwining? You take a Markov process, two-dimensional Markov process, and you want to know whether one of the two coordinates itself is a Markov process. Okay, so you take this Markov process with generator G hat, and you assume that you're given a probability kernel K, and the associated operator of K acting on mappings from E to F, mappings from E times F to R, is KF, which integrates this kernel here, K against F, F against K. And now the theorem by Rogers and Pittman says that if there exists a generator G of a Markov process in E, such that for each F in the domain of G hat, you have this intertwining equality, then provided that you start in this state, the law of Y0 conditionally on X0 is given by the kernel K, then almost surely at all times, it's always the case for the law of YT and with this Markov property here. And X is a Markov process with generator G. So what we try to do is the following, is to consider a lower dimensional process, which is called the weight measure. So the weights of lineages are defined as follows. So for each lineage, you count the number of times that it has been hit by a coalescent from below, from level one. Okay. So here you have your species that was the youngest coalesces here, and then as time passes, it goes down and down. And here you have your experience one coalescence from below, and here a second one, and then here when this lineage lands at level one, it has weight three, okay? And then when it goes back to another level, a greater level, it's reset to one, okay? You can also have another picture of this definition. Imagine that all these lineages are actually tubes which embody the species. And in each of these tubes, you put the lineages coming from below, and you delay the coalescences of these lineages. So you imagine that in this tube, you have just one lineage, then two lineages, then three lineages, and only at this time, you coalesce the three lineages, okay? So imagine that you have delayed lineages in each of these tubes. So what we did is applied intertwining to this lower dimensional process by calling WT of L the weight of level L. So you have a tube at level L, how many delayed lineages is there in this tube? And you count the total number of delayed lineages. So there's more delayed lineages than actual lineages in your sample. And then you can prove easily that NT, the number of delayed lineages, so the lineages that only coalesce when they leave level one, is a lambda coalescent with a very simple lambda measure, with just the Dirac delta at one minus alpha. And conditional on this process, the weight measure, or let's say the levels of the levels of your lineages, are IID geometric random variables. Okay? So you can just throw IID random variables to get the levels from the number of delayed lineages. Of course, what we want is not the number of delayed lineages, but the real distribution of levels. And so now we characterize, let's say we characterize the process by the number of lineages with weight W. So here we lose the information about the levels. And we only take into account the weights of levels, of lineages. Now, BT is a Markov process, so that's an intertwining equality that ensures that. It's a Markov process, and conditional on the knowledge of this configuration, the total configuration of levels can be obtained by independent geometric random variables conditioned to be pairwise distinct. Okay, so we can do a much quicker inference from real trees if we know how to augment the data with the weights. And that's what we did. I show you so simulated trees with different alphas. So for alpha close to zero, you have trees that are very imbalanced. So here you have two simulated trees with 20 tips. Because when alpha is close to zero, the youngest species has a overwhelming abundance compared to the other species, and so it's always the youngest species that gives rise to the new species. When alpha increases, you get more balanced trees, and so this for alpha equals 0.7, you get really the trees that are the most similar to real phylogenies. And when alpha is close to one, you get trees that are very similar to the Kingman coalescent. And actually, we can show, thanks to the weight representation, that as alpha tends to one, the process of weights, the configuration of weights properly accelerated, converges to weights that are to lineages, to a configuration where lineages all have the weight one, and they're in number nt, where nt is the Kingman pure death rate. Okay, so what happens actually is that when alpha is close to one, the distribution of abundances is close to a uniform distribution. All the species have the same distribution, and so they are exchangeable, and we are back to the Kingman situation. So we have a process that interpolates between the Kingman coalescent and the caterpillar tree. So we did some inference. Augmenting with the weights or with levels when alpha is not too small. And so when you take the caterpillar tree, you get this posterior distribution of alpha. When you introduce a little balance here, you see that the alpha already shifts to the right. And for a perfectly balanced tree, you have an alpha that's close to one. And I think I will stop here by the conclusion. So we have devised a simple model of phylogeny based on an individual-based model of evolution under the Red Queen hypothesis. And we discovered that there is this paper in Ecology Letters which treats exactly the same model, but not concentrating on phylogenies. We have obtained a reduction of state space for fast simulation and inference of the phylogeny, thanks to this weight measure, and this result that ensures that the tree converges to the Kingman tree. Work in progress, we are trying to get the distributions of well-known statistics in phylogenetics versus alpha. So we just heard that a new statistic is the random length sequence that we could also implement here. And we try to do inference in the transient phase. So the phase where the number of species increases and is not equal to infinity. And what we what we're currently doing with the help of Veronica, who is in the audience and starting her PhD in September, is a new model where instead of a competition matrix, which is a triangular, it would be diagonal by blocks, with the idea that when new species arise, some might colonize a new continent or a new niche and interact only with its descendants until the next colonization occurs. So that's for the institutions. Thanks to my co-authors, to the members of the group's SMILE, Stochastic Models for the Inference of Life Evolution. So the co-authors are Guillaume, Nicolas, and Todd, and you can see them here. So Veronica is here, and you have already crossed the way of Emmanuel, of Milaine, François, and Todd. I think that's all. And if you want to have a special, if you want to listen to some people that are hard to catch, like Joshua Plotkin or Rick Deret, you can come to this conference in July in College de France. Thank you very much.